behalf of Bethany Boeke, Norman Pearson, and their respective families, welcome. Welcome this day when two are joined together as one, inside of friends, family, and most importantly, inside of God. You may be seated. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the grace given to Norman and to Bethany. And we ask now that by your Holy Spirit, you would attend this ceremony and be blessed and be pleased as we proclaim you both in your word and by bringing these two wonderful people together. And we pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. Norman, do you know that God has given Bethany to you as your wife to glorify him in your marriage? Have you gained consent from her father to take her as your wife? Bethany, do you know that God has given Norman to you as your husband to glorify him in your marriage?
Yes.
Has your father consented in this marriage?
Yes.
With this declaration of consent, Bethany's father will now give Norman Bethany's hand.
I gotta get it together for a second here. I have my three girls, and this is the last of my daughters getting married. We've talked about what to talk about today. We're gonna talk about relationships. For about the last 9 years, I've been teaching in a college course on various religions. And while you've come from a pastor's home and a professor's home, and you've come from a policeman's home, you might think that's good enough. But we need a relationship, even more than a religion. Because as I've taught all those different studies about how we try to reach God, I found there's really only two. And that is a religion of what we can do in order to try to make God smile upon us and take us to heaven. And you never quite know if you're going to make it. Or a relationship with Jesus Christ that we're going to talk about today. And so we're going to talk about relationships first with God and then with each other. A great passage of scripture is Romans 6:23, the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And I want to think about a picture this morning, or this afternoon, I guess. In Ephesians chapter 2, God paints a picture. And the Apostle Paul thinks about a broad canvas. And he starts with looking at us in our original relationship with God. And think of dark colors. Think of storm clouds. Think of blacks and dark blues and all those things. And when Paul puts it this way, and he's saying, you were, and he's talking to those who are believers now in Jesus Christ and know they're on their way to heaven because of their relationship. And he says this, and you were in the past dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work, and the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of our body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, like the rest of mankind. For us, we know that you don't have to teach a child to be selfish, to grab at their own toys when somebody else wants it, and to scream when they don't get their own way. And that comes out of their old nature, which you have gotten from your parents, and we got from our parents, and it goes all the way back in Scripture to the Garden of Eden with Adam and Eve. And so, most of the time over the years, when I've talked to people, they don't have much problem in saying, yes, I know I've sinned. I know that I haven't been perfect before God. I know that I am in need and I feel my sense of guilt. But the scripture goes on in the very next part. Well, you know, we've painted that kind of ugly picture of what we once were. Now I want you to think of something more glorious. And that is the idea of, that's the idea of a cross. And that's the idea of something that reaches to God. Because here we begin with verse 4, but God. And so we have a tremendous contrast. This is what we once were, but now consider what we are now in our relationship with Jesus Christ. And it goes on to say, but God being rich in mercy because of his great love with which he loved us. God is a God of love. That's not his only attribute, but he loved us even while we were yet sinners. Even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ, for by grace you have been saved. I look down at one of the most familiar verses in Scripture for many folks, and that's Ephesians 2:8. For by grace you have been saved through faith. This is not your own doing, but it's a gift of God. I want you to think of grace as God's favor upon undeserving people. When we think of the word grace, we can also think of the word loving kindness and mercy. And so while we were in that particular point of being alienated from God, God in his mercy sent Jesus Christ to die on the cross to pay the penalty for our sin. Because Paul goes on in another passage and says the wages of sin is death. And so we were in big trouble. We were alienated from God, but God in his mercy says, I love them and I will provide a way. So it's not what we can do, it's what Jesus Christ, God's Son, has already done and that has provided a way. And so we accept that grace. Now think about it. Grace is not something you earn, is it? Otherwise, it's no longer grace. In fact, it goes on to say that you've been saved by grace. It is the gift of God. I want you to think of grace and gift going together. And when you receive a gift, you can't earn it. The Bible goes on to say here, not a result of works, so that no one can boast. When we talk about religion, it's what we can do in order for God to smile upon us and give us favor. When we talk about grace, it's what God has already done, and we simply receive as a gift. And in that gift, he gives us eternal life. He gives us forgiveness from sins. He gives us the freedom from guilt. And there is a tremendous joy as we do that. And our only part is in accepting it by faith, by belief, by saying, yes, I know that the cross of Christ was for me. In that, God establishes a relationship with us, not on the basis of what we have done, not on the basis of our works, being good and all those things, but on the basis of the cross, grace, the gift. Well, I received Christ when I was almost 5 years old. I understood it because it had shown me from the Word of God. And the two of you have expressed that as well. As I think you're going to express in a little while. And so for any of us here this morning, hearing this Word of God, for us to say, I'm a sinner, I know that. There's that picture of dark. Then that cross which reaches to God. And there are the yellows and golds and the beauty in that picture of a relationship with him and eternal life and sins forgiven. So I can say I'm a sinner. Jesus Christ has paid the price for my sin on the cross. And by faith, I take his payment that I may be right with God. And at that moment, I become a child of God. Therefore, we put together what God has said here in this passage, his grace, his gift, and the guarantee that at that moment we have eternal life. That's a tremendous truth for any of us, for all of us, that want to have a right relationship with God, and ultimately then a right relationship with others, with each other, which is really the foundation for your marriage. Because you're going to need in that relationship, not only with God, but with each other, grace and faith. As a husband, you're going to love your wife as as Christ loved the church, Paul goes on to say in the same book. She comes before your interests as a wife to respect and honor your husband, as Paul also says in this passage, and to recognize that we still have an old sin nature, that it's not always easy. I've talked with the two of you. You've had some discussions that were not as gracious as you might like. Bethany, you were raised in a home that, even though your dad was a pastor, you've seen him get mad. And you've seen your father and mother argue, not probably always with gracious tones at all. But to be able to go back and ask forgiveness for each other and from God, and to have the understanding that God is at work in our homes as we submit to Him and have a relationship with Him. So you've already known some of each other's foibles, idiosyncrasies, weaknesses, sins, whatever we might call them. And we know today that you'll be able to get along as you talk about it and as you relate to each other, as you relate to God. It's God's power to go together through life's joys and trials. You do not know what is going to happen in the next 20, 40, 60 years of marriage. You're going to have some great times, and you will probably have some difficult times that today you cannot see, and aren't you glad? But God is faithful, and He will walk you through that as long as you walk with Him till death parts you. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this dear couple whom we know and love. We ask for your understanding in their lives of who you are and of how you work. And through this marriage, they will not only know each other, but they will know you in how you sustain them in times of testings and trials. You bring them joy through so many blessings that you give. And Father, most of all, that you give them and all of us eternal life when we trust and have that relationship with you. Thank you, God, for being the great God that you are. We don't always understand your ways. We're not God, you are. And we're even thankful for that. But Father, we ask your blessing upon them as they walk with you in these days and months and years ahead. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Well, as Dr. Boki said, we do have a wonderful God that we serve. And if you think about it, we are all here a product of promises. Whether they were promises kept or whether they were promises broken, the role of promises in our life cannot be overstated. In the Bible, is full of assurances of how God treats us according to His promises. And the promises He makes towards us, even when we fail. And His promise is that He will never fail us, even though we fail Him. And what Norman and Bethany are standing here to do is to make a promise to one another. But they have invited you so that when they make the promise, they're making the same promise that God has made us. That when He enters in relationship with us, it is a relationship where, because of His promise, because of His faithfulness, we will flourish under His care. Because God invented marriage, not just because it was good for us, which it is, but it is a play or a story of how God loves us and nourishes us and how we are to flourish under His care. And now Norman and Bethany have written a declaration of consent to one another, which they will share with each other now.
Ephesians 5:33 reads, "Let each one of you love his wife as himself, and let the wife see that she respects her husband." God's design providentially included roles, equally yet uniquely and individually designed to complement one another. Adam and Eve, Christ and his church, man and woman, strength and beauty, love and respect. It is in this wisdom that I find direction for how we relate to one another. Romantic love alone is temporary and prone to failure upon the first sign of trouble. Biblical love, on the other hand, is described not as a fleeting feeling, but an intentional and conscious choice one makes. It is real, selfless, and permanent. It defies time, difficult seasons, and the multitude of earthly distractions. Jesus exemplified this kind of love when he offered the gift of heaven by dying for us on the cross. He acted on our behalf when we didn't deserve it. This, by God's strength, is the kind of unconditional love I profess to you before all of these witnesses. The first and most important quality I love about you is your love for God. There was an honest testimony behind that infectious smile and those big, pretty eyes. Through life's trials, you've allowed your faith to guide you, even if God allowed some hard lessons along the way. Like all mankind, we too are sinful creatures deserving of eternal condemnation without a Savior. For this reason, saying I do today is not the most significant decision you'll ever make. You've already made that all-important choice. At a young age, you accepted God's free gift of eternal life by believing that He alone has rescued you from your sins. That is awesome. I can't think of a better woman to set a godly example for those around us who have not yet come to know God in their life. Your relationship with Him supersedes all things, and I'll gladly take that second spot. I love you, and I cannot wait to start our journey together.
I promise to bear your children and raise them in a nurturing home that is Christ-centered.
Norman repeat after me. I, Norman, take thee, Bethany.
I, Norman, take thee, Bethany.
To be my wedded wife.
To be my wedded wife.
To have and to hold from this day forward.
To have and to hold from this day forward.
For better, for worse.
For better, for worse.
For richer, for poorer.
For richer, for poorer.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
Till death do us part.
Till death do us part.
According to God's holy ordinance.
According to God's holy ordinance.
I pledge to you my faithfulness.
I pledge to you my faithfulness.
Please, Bethany, repeat after me. I, Bethany, take thee, Norman.
I, Bethany, take thee, Norman.
To be my wedded husband.
To be my wedded husband.
To have and to hold from this day forward.
To have and to hold from this day forward.
For better, for worse.
For better, for worse.
For richer, for poorer.
For richer, for poorer.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
Till death do us part.
Till death do us part.
According to God's holy ordinance.
According to God's holy ordinance.
I pledge to you my faith.
I pledge to you my faith.
We fix our eyes not on what is seen, but what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. Wedding rings serve as the symbol of the covenant that you have just spoken. They are an outward sign of an invisible love which binds your hearts together. You may have been experienced. And Norman, please repeat after me. I give you this ring. As a symbol of my covenant love.
As a symbol of my covenant love.
Bethany, please repeat after me. I give you this ring.
I give you this ring.
As a symbol of my covenant love.
As a symbol of my covenant
love. Thank you.
For as much as the couple have consented together in holy matrimony, and have declared the same before God and in the presence of this company, I pronounce them husband and wife. What God has joined together, let no man put asunder. I now present to you Mr. and Mrs. Norman Pearson.